I can smell the mountain air, and my ears are popping. We must be getting close to the top.
They told us they've got a clear signal, and we're about to go over the top of the mountain. This is it. I can feel it.
That's your seatbelt.
That's not very encouraging. There are no seatbelts.
I'm riding a locomotive at the rear of a Norfolk Southern coal train. We're pushing 15,000 tons of coal to a power plant on the other side of the Allegheny Mountains in western Pennsylvania. We're about to descend into an engineering marvel known as the Horseshoe Curve. In the 1850s, the Pennsylvania Railroad had a problem. The route across the Alleghenies led over a pass into a steep-sided valley and then over another pass. But the drop in and out of the valley was so steep that no train could do it. To solve the problem, the Pennsylvania Railroad built tracks around the head of the valley in a huge curve shaped like a horseshoe. The Horseshoe Curve is one of the great engineering feats of the 19th century, but it came at a cost.
The Pennsylvania Railroad brought in thousands of immigrants to build the curve. These guys were only getting paid 25 cents an hour to build their piece of the American dream. If it wasn't for these guys and their raw muscle, this railroad would have never been here.
In 1854, the Horseshoe Curve was completed. With the aid of helper locomotives, trains climb the steep grades over the pass. Then they go down into the curved track around the head of the valley. Because the curve itself is on a gradual incline, the train can go faster and remain under control. Once out of the curve, the train still has enough momentum to get over the next mountain pass. When the Horseshoe Curve opened in 1854, the trip from Pittsburgh to Philadelphia was cut from 3.5 days to 12 hours.
All this stuff right here, pushing the train up over the mountain, bringing it down the mountain, guys like John and Ron here, it's all about getting the coal to the power plant. So what do you think's harder as a pusher crew? Is it harder going up the hill or harder going down the hill?
Going down the hill.
Going down the hill. I thought you were going to say that.
We're still pushing the rear of our train up the mountain, but our lead locomotives have already begun their descent.
So more than half the train is going down the hill right now.
Yes.
And I noticed that you've throttled off, so it's kind of starting to pull us now. We're going over the top right now. You can see it right there, how it's gone up, and now we're going down. This is where the craziness begins. It's all downhill from here.
We're nearing the descent into the Horseshoe Curve. Our brakes had better work. Trains have been making this journey for over 150 years. And if you want to know how steam trains were able to stop, there's only one place to find out, Steamtown.
In the 1830s, if you wanted to stop an engine, a railroad employee would get in front of it, dig his boots into the ground, stop it with his heels. But when the railroad started making engines this big right here, they had to come up with another way, and that's when they invented the brake shoe. Brake shoes work by pressing against the wheel. There's a lot of friction involved to stop this train, a lot of wear and tear on these brake shoes. Just like on your car, you gotta have them serviced once in a while. A locomotive like this would have its brake shoes inspected every day. Looks like that's what Mike's doing right now. Let's go down and take a look. Mike, what's going on?
We have to change this brake shoe out, Matt. It's bad. For one, it's worn out, and now it's got a big crack in it. You can't have a defect like that on your brakes.
Okay, I can see the crack right here. There's a nice big crack in there. So we have a defective brake shoe, and Mike's going to change it out.
Unless you want to do it, Matt.
I'll tell you what, Mike, I'll take a crack at it.
First, we'll take this bar and make some space so we can get at the steel brake pad.
A lot of places to bang your head around here, so I'm gonna just stick this in. Ah, okay. Push it back.
That's pretty loose in here, so we can just take it out by hand.
All right.
So now you wanna lift the shoe off of there.
It doesn't feel very natural.
No.
Lift it back.
Yeah, let's see if we can.
So I just need to slide the old shoe down. Nice and easy.
There you go. All right. We'll get that later.
Right into the pit. I have a feeling we're going to be going down there a little later anyway. I hope there wasn't anybody down there. We have this brand new brake shoe here. Back in the day, how long would one of these brake shoes last?
You might get 10,000 miles out of a set of shoes.
Any kind of warranty on that?
No warranty.
All right. These marks here are indicators on when to change the brake shoe. When they wear down, it means it's time to change it. So we're gonna take this 25-pound brake shoe. I'm gonna start it up at the top of the wheel here. Yes!
Yeah.
Let's slide this.
Slide this.
This is some serious hard labor.
Yeah.
Ready?
All right.
Yeah. There we go.
All right.
I think you got it.
I think I got it. Oh, I can feel it tighten right up there.
And then you just tap it right in. And that's it.
If the brakes don't work, you're looking at a train wreck.
Although today's trains still have brake shoes, there are new techniques to deal with harrowing stretches of track like the Allegheny Ridge. Our train uses a technique called dynamic braking. Dynamic braking uses the locomotive's traction motors to slow the train down. When dynamic braking is engaged, the engineer takes power from the traction motors that drive the train's wheels. The resistance in the engine makes the wheels harder to turn, effectively slowing the wheels and the speed of the train. It's like putting your car into low gear. You actually let the resistance of the engine hold the train back.
You've just come out of dynamic braking. What were you doing?
What we were doing is we were holding the train back in the dynamic brake. So he was holding back from the front end and we were holding back from the rear. And then once the brakes take hold, I slowly leave my dynamic brake off. And now we're just going along for the ride more or less.
Running this train through the Alleghenies is a constant struggle between man and nature. It's this train versus gravity.
But your job's not over, is it?
It's never over.
In fact, the hardest part of the job has just begun. History has shown that even experienced crews have fallen prey to the hazards of the Alleghenies. 1925, a 58-car freight train loses braking power on the steepest section of the descent into the horseshoe curve, derailing the train and killing two crewmen. 1947, the eastbound Red Arrow train derails just west of Horseshoe Curve and rolls down the mountain. 24 people were killed and 126 were injured. I hope we're not going to make that kind of history today, because we're now entering the Horseshoe Curve.
That is incredible!
Riding on a Norfolk Southern coal train through western Pennsylvania. Right now, we're going around an amazing 220-degree bend called the Horseshoe Curve.
I've always wanted to go around Horseshoe Curve. This is incredible.
The Horseshoe Curve is 1,800 feet across and a half mile long, which is why we can see the other end of our mile-long train from the engineer's window.
It's directly on the other side of us. That is incredible.
In 1966, the Horseshoe Curve was designated a National Historic Landmark. And every year, over a half million people come to watch 15,000-ton trains like ours whip around the curve.
Woo-hoo-hoo! Yeah!
Since the 1850s, this route has been a vital artery linking the resource-rich hills of western Pennsylvania to the East Coast. So important, in fact, that in World War II, the Horseshoe Curve was the target of a Nazi bombing plot. In 1942, eight Nazi agents set out on a deadly mission to destroy American supply lines to the East Coast. The goal? To cripple cities like New York and Washington and bring the country to its knees. The plot was only foiled when two of the German agents turned themselves in to the FBI. We can only guess what would have happened had the plot been carried out. The dangers facing today's crews aren't the stuff of spy thrillers, but they're just as scary. The steep grades and heavy traffic along this route mean a daily mashing of steel wheels and steel rails. In fact, more than 70 trains per day pass through the curve. And with that comes the constant threat of a derailment. So Norfolk Southern needs to make sure that this curved rail holds up.